diferentes. Los tres investigadores provienen del IHE, que es el Institute for Water Education Delft. Bueno, la primera de estas tres charlas la va a dar el profesor Eddie Morse. Voy a dar una breve reseña de él en inglés. So we have today our first guest is Professor Eddie Morse, who has a very impressive academic track record. He's an expert in different subjects related to water science, mostly hydrology and terrestrial ecosystems within a global change context. He's a very cited researcher. His research actually has been cited more, almost 12,000 times by his academic peers. And actually, in addition for being a well-known researcher, he's the rector of the IHE Delft since July of this year. Before that, he was the head of the research team, Climate Change and Adaptive Land and Water Management at Wageningen University in Netherlands. He's also professor of water and climate at the Free University of Amsterdam. He completed his PhD in 2012, focusing in the interaction between the atmosphere and the Earth. Professor Morse specialized in the research of climate change, mitigation and adaptation. And before becoming professor in Netherlands, he worked for the World Meteorological Organization, mostly in Africa and the Caribbean. So today he will give a short presentation about, topic? Yeah? Climate change. Climate change, yes, climate change. So let's welcome Professor Eddie Morse.
So thank you very much, and thank you also that I have the opportunity to say a few words to you. What I wanted to do this afternoon is actually say something for two parts. One is climate change, and the second part is I also would like to say a few words about IHE Delft, the institute that I'm rector of at the moment. I think climate change, there are a lot of topics that you could address. What I want to do today is just to say a few general issues that are at stake. I was at the meeting in Bonn at COP23, where a couple of topics were discussed. Also, slightly connected to that, I think the sustainable development goals are important. There was a UN Water meeting in The Hague just 1 week ago, about how you could do the monitoring and also how you could do the implementations. Most countries, they have to submit their baseline report, actually this year. Not all countries have done that, but I think it's very interesting if you have the opportunity to have a look at the reports that will come out soon, because those reports will also indicate where the gaps are. So I think as a researcher, it's probably, I think, very nice to know a little bit not only say in depth what your research is about, but also a little bit what society is expecting from you, and also where they are looking for help from you. So first, a couple of words about climate change. This is an image that comes from the Global Carbon Project. That's a global initiative where they try to bring together all information that they have to say something about what the present status is. And what you see here, actually, this just came out before COP23, because they used this report actually to inform the governments a bit, okay, where are we and where are we going? And I guess that most of you know what is at stake with climate change. There is a big discussion about, say, are we able to reduce our emissions? Or are we able to stabilize our emissions? And if you look at the graph over here, I gave a similar presentation last year. So then the red line was not there. And that was a little bit hopeful. So it looked as if we are getting finally at the level where we would be able to, say, at least stabilize our CO2 emissions. But as you can see, the projections for 2017, and it's still projection because we are still living in December at the moment, But it looks like as if we will have a new increase actually on our CO2 emissions. And then I think if you look at what we're aiming for, and that's, if possible, 2 degrees temperature change, and preferably 1.5 degrees, because we also do have some small islands in the Pacific and the Caribbean that will not be able to sustain a 2-degree temperature increase. So if you look here, then you see that the 2017 projection is that we're not really able as yet to stabilize our emissions. And as you may have seen, because you can just get it from the website, from the UNFCCC, is that even if you would add all our pledges to reduce our emissions, then we still would most likely aim for something like 3 to 3.5 degree temperature change. So that means that we're somewhere, say, ending up in this region over here, but we would like to be here. So that means that there is still some work to be done. It also means that the present changes that are happening in climate will persist. So it means that we may count on a further temperature increase. We may count on also the present changes that are taking place for precipitation to continue. Now, climate change and also the discussions in Bonn were on two major topics. One is on mitigation, the other one is on adaptation, and then maybe just one slide on mitigation side. Mitigation of emissions is very closely linked to our energy use. So if you look at what is happening there, is a lot of research and a lot of efforts are being done to change, say, the energy consumption that we have. And there are two ways of doing that. One is, of course, to reduce our energy use, our energy demand. But secondly, also to see if we can change the different sources of energy use. And in there, of course, renewables are an interesting new source. Now, here there are two things that are important. One is energy generation. So how much energy is generated? So that's the left-hand slide. And on your right-hand side, you see the cost of energy. Because depending on the cost of energy, companies or users may decide to switch from one source to another source. So that's very important here. I think the good news is that if you look at the energy generation, then the energy generated by fossil fuel, you see that the numbers are going down, the projections are going down even further. And you also see that the price is going up in general. Yes. So that means as long as you have that combination, that will support actually other changes. And those other changes, one important one is solar energy there. So what you see in a number of countries actually is that all the predictions on the use of solar energies are going much, much faster than were foreseen. And just as an example, if you look at a country like India, they predicted a certain change towards solar energy, but they already say adjusted their national objectives by a factor 3. So they already see that they will produce 3 times as more solar energy than they foreseen. And that was just 5 years ago. So that's a very fast change. And you see that also in some of the other, say, renewable energy sources that are there. So that about mitigation. But what is important as well is that climate will change. And I just put a few slides here, where on the left-hand side you see the things that are a little bit stronger related to temperature, while on the right-hand side a little bit more to precipitation. The reason for me to put this here is that often people think about temperature change and then they're thinking about average temperature, or if they think about precipitation, you think about total precipitation. What is important is actually that you look at this from the standpoint of the end user. So if you are a farmer, you will have another interest. If you are a mother of small children, you will have another interest. So everybody has a different interest. And what I think is important is that you should look also at how some changes are happening. Now, just one example, I don't think it's even on these slides, is that what you see globally is that the difference between the night and daytime temperature is getting smaller. So that means that I think you have a very nice climate here in Mexico. I would love to come back. Nice part is that it's cold during the night, because you need a temperature that goes below 26 degrees at night to recover. Otherwise, your physiological system is not able to recover as much. So if the number of days that you will not meet this threshold, so that the temperature at night is going to be above this 26 degrees, it's bad for your health. And that's not often directly translated, but you see that back in, for example, the production levels of people working in an office or working somewhere else. So sometimes it's a little bit hidden, but it's there. So that is just one example there. Then I think this is coming from the IPCC fifth assessment report. The reason to show this is also that I think it's about communication. So it's about engaging with stakeholders. And I think what this one does is it tells you a little bit about, in the different regions, what are the issues at hand and how well are we able to predict or to foresee that those changes are taking place. So if you look at say, Mexico, say, or the region here, you're sitting in this area here, and what you see there is that it's expected that there will be changes taking place on fish, and that means that you will see different sorts of fish, maybe less fish, or fish moving to other areas. It also means that if you look at the picture over there, that also water is also going to be an issue. And that is often translated in more periods with a longer severe drought, but also more precipitation in shorter terms, so possibly generating flooding. So the INDCs were the pledges that were done by the individual countries. I just put a few things from the INDC of Mexico. Who has read it already, the INDCs? If not, I think it's interesting to read it, if you're interested. For me, but I just took a couple of things out, so maybe you take some other things out of there. First of all, vulnerability. If you look at the numbers that are there, they're huge numbers. So if you look here, that's $48 million, so we're talking about loss, $1.4 billion loss. That not only means that you're losing there, but that there should be an interest to invest actually to prevent those losses. And that, I think, is opening an opportunity to do something about what's happening there. And I think investment, so the financial side is important. In climate change, there's the Green Climate Fund as one of the big funds. And in there, I think they're looking for, say, new methods, how you could build a case to finance a project that really contributes, one, to reduce the emissions, and secondly, to adapt, so to implement certain measures that will help you to live under changing climate conditions. Now, a second one is what was also mentioned here in by the government of Mexico is the number of municipalities that they would like to reduce, and that they are vulnerable to climate change, and that's by, say, roughly something like 30% in Mexico. Then in the INDC, there's a much better description, but there are three main areas for adaptation. So one is adaptation to climate change for the social sector. So that's one is very strongly linked actually to those vulnerable municipalities. So it's about equity. So how can you help them? And the second one is about ecosystem-based adaptation. So that means that you look if you can use the strength of ecosystems to do something about climate change. So that could be that you think about how can I use, for example, forest, how can I use wetlands to also help to prevent flooding, or how can you establish wetlands to have, say, water available during periods of drought. So that's ecosystem-based adaptation. And the third one is adaptation of strategic infrastructure and productive systems. So that's about transportation, largely, and about agribusiness. So it's also about food and how you could improve on that one. Then I think I put this one here because I think that's also important for the university here, but also for us as IHG Delft. So that's what you see here is about capacity building and technology transfer. And that's one of the reasons also why we're here, is that we would like to look at how we can do this in a collaboration also with the institute here. And I think what is interesting is also, say, these five topics here. And if you look at these topics, then four out of five are very strongly related to water. So it also means that water is one of the main issues about climate adaptation. Then just a few words about IHG Delft. So IHG Delft is an institute, so not a university, but an institute in Delft in the Netherlands. What we try to do is we try to improve capacity development, especially in the global south. And we do that based on three pillars. One is education, one is research, and one is institutional strengthening. On education side, we're providing MSc programs. We have four, and we will start with the fifth MSc program in April next year. We have a number of short courses, and we have online courses. And maybe already you can see it a little bit from the picture here. The percentage of Dutch students is about one. So that means that 99% are mainly coming from outside of the Netherlands and even outside of Europe. So what we're trying to do at the institute is also to create actually an institutional setting where people from all over, say, the world, especially from, say, the global south, are coming together. The nice thing is that it's mostly people from a mid-career position, so people who have been working already in the water sector. They bring their problems from their home country there, and both from the lecturers, but as much from the colleagues, they get feedback on their problems. So it's about learning with the lecturers, of course, but as much as possible also with their colleagues. So that's what we try to push a bit. And then this is just an overview that it's not something we do alone. So we have a number of joint programs. And here you just see that. It changes, of course. This is a snapshot of 2016. And we see that sometimes the collaborations are stopped because in those countries they then provide the training by themselves, which is perfectly fine. And other new countries come in or new topics come in, and then we start those joint programming initiatives again. We also do research. There are roughly 140 PhD students walking around, and that's mainly done in a setting where the PhD students work half-time, so 2 years, in their home country on their specific topic, because like I said, they have to bring their own problem. And half of the time, they work at IHG Delft to analyze and study these topics. And sometimes, depending a little bit on the topic, is they also use the lab facilities that we have at IHG Delft. That is not something that you do in a monodisciplinary setting, but you do it in an integrated setting. Comes forward a little bit from here. These are the different 13 chair groups that we have. And as you can see, the topics range from really technical topics towards more social economic topics like governance and others. And on the top, you see the six research teams that we have at present. And you can see by the circles there that there is, say, an engagement of the different disciplines in those different research topics. Then the last pillar, the third one, is institutional strengthening. And what we do there is we work together with public partners, but sometimes also private partners, and we help them actually to achieve what they would like to do. And that can be something like developing a new curriculum for a university, setting up a new pilot system for water treatment. So we help them to introduce a new system and how that works. This is a picture that shows something where We designed a new eco-toilet that can be used especially for disasters or directly after disasters. So you could very fast say reintroduce toilets there to prevent diseases. So we do different things like that. And again, that's in line with what we think is important, is that we want to have applied research and applied things that can be used in the different countries. So what we are looking for is also this reaching out, where we are looking for a collaboration on the education side, so the different courses that we're providing, but also to develop research topics together and see if we can do institutional strengthening projects. And of course, what's important in there is to identify funding opportunities for example, for fellowships, but also for the research projects that we think are of interest. So that's actually what I wanted to say briefly about climate change and IHE Delft as institute. So thank you for your attention.
Para alguien que quiera hacer preguntas.
Yeah.
What was the picture taken?
Which one? With the graduate?
The toilet.
The toilet. Oh, good question. Do you? Is it?
We have one case in Cuba.
Yeah, could be that this is in Cuba. I'm not 100% sure. I can ask for you if you like. You recognize somebody?
No.
No, okay.
It was like Central America, like Honduras.
Yeah, it could well be, or on the
yeah.
I don't know, but like I said, we work say in Latin America, but also in Asia and Africa. So, yeah, you're interested in a toilet like this?
The thing is, that toilet is like better than most of the toilets they have over there.
Yeah,
I'm from Honduras.
Yeah,
so I know how.
Okay. Yeah, and by the way, this is the old design. I just saw last week the pictures of the new design that we have. They're much flashier than this one. And they're now going to test one until it really breaks down, because they just want to say how durable it is. So they're going to test it in Ghana. And then based on that, what we're trying to do is we're talking with a company in India who wants to sell them on the market there. So we're looking if they're interested to do it like that. Yeah. Welcome.
It's about the coastal zones.
Yeah.
Because we are from the coastal.
Yes.
So we are interested in the coastal zone in the chairs and research things that you show. Maybe aquatic, right?
If you look at coastal systems, engineering and port development is one of them. But they're also linked very much to other issues, so on the water management side as well. But coastal zones is indeed an important one. So also coastal zones related to nature-based solutions is something that we're looking at. Yeah. Any other questions? You're all going to reduce your emissions, I hope, after today. I've seen some nice examples. We just visited Environmental Institute. So I think that's a very nice example of how things can be done. So congratulations for that. Yeah?
Another comment.
Yeah.
I was interested in applying to IHE with a scholarship from Bill Gates and Melinda.
Yeah, yes.
Foundation.
Yeah.
And as you said, you asked for people who has worked before in the water.
Yeah.
Engineering. But the thing is, in my country, for example, it's really hard for us young people to get a work, like get a job in hydraulics, for example.
Yeah.
So how does it work, for example, from people like from countries like Honduras, El Salvador, Guatemala?
Now, there is an emphasis on having people coming from a professional career, but it's not excluded. What is very important is your motivation. So your motivation letter is important, and also, say, your academic degrees. So that will play a role. I know from the Melinda Gates Foundation, because there were 2,000 applicants there. So, and I think we only have 13 places the first year, but we will get more in the years after. And we hope that this same course will be also taught at other institutions over the world, so that it will not only be in Delft, but also at other places, because we think there's a huge interest there in we are not able to accommodate all those persons.
Yeah. It was interesting to me that it was a joint program, like Colombia and Netherlands.
Yeah.
And the whole master's program was $50,000.
Yeah.
And the Melinda Gates Foundation gave $25,000, right?
Yeah.
So it was asked for us to have the other $25,000. Mm-hmm. So it wasn't like, it's difficult, very difficult for us to spend the money.
Yeah. Yeah. No, we appreciate that, and we're doing a lot of efforts actually to look for other fellowship funding. But I think it's also something that is changing globally. So I don't think that I see the funding sources going up very fast. So I see more challenges, let's call it like that, to see if you can find different funding sources together. We also work, for example, with the Rotary Foundation. So in some cases, what we're also looking for is if we can bring different funding sources together to enable a student to still come. And I know that there are more and more students that take a loan, also especially if it's partly funded. And then some students say, know that the chances that we'll get a job and are able to pay back the loan are so big that they see the advantage of getting a private loan in there. So that's also happening, not everywhere, but in a number of countries. So the whole picture is getting more mixed.
Okay.
I think you have had all your questions, but maybe also of interest to the others. But thank you all for your attention. And if you have questions, you can always come to Delft. Thank you.
Okay, el segundo presentador es el doctor Gerald Corso. Él va a dar su presentación en español. El doctor Gerald Corso actualmente es profesor, bueno, senior lecturer en el departamento de hidroinformática, igual en el IH de Delft. Él es, bueno, formación es ingeniero civil, con un background en ciencias, bueno, en computación, programación y modelación. Durante su doctorado, que fue precursor en este ámbito de la hidroinformática, desarrolló modelos y métodos híbridos para integrar algoritmos inteligentes y modelos conceptuales hidrológicos. También, bueno, el doctor Corso cuenta con amplia experiencia en lo que es modelación de los recursos hídricos utilizando tecnología de las TIC avanzadas, tecnologías de información y comunicación. Y, bueno, en los últimos 4 años ha estado trabajando en el uso de modelos hidrológicos a la escala global y realizando análisis de incertidumbre para escenarios de cambio climático. En el 2012 fue ganador del premio Tyson, que es el premio que se le da a los mejores científicos en hidrología de la Asociación Internacional de Ciencias Hidrológicas. Por favor, gracias.
No sé si... ¿Aló? ¿Con este? Bueno, sí, con este. Bueno, buenas tardes. Hoy la idea de este mini simposio es presentarles un poco de las experiencias que tenemos en UNESCO IDH. Ya vieron la primera presentación de Eddie, donde se hace una introducción del cambio climático y algunas cosas que probablemente enlazan con muchos de los programas académicos que tenemos dentro del instituto. En lo que el área que les voy a hablar ahora es la de hidroinformática, y de hecho yo soy el coordinador del Master of Arms en hidroinformática, en la especialización. Y en esa área quería mostrarles un poco de las experiencias que tenemos. Pero antes de entrar a las experiencias, quería tal vez resaltar un poco qué es o por qué nace la hidroinformática, o que, por qué hidroinformática. Y en eso... van a encontrar que hay en el pasado la hidroinformática nació con computational hydraulics, en donde se empezaba a hacer los primeros modelos, eran las primeras ecuaciones, elementos finitos, hacer una representación de ecuaciones por diferencias divididas finitas y empezar a representar fluidos. Hoy en día ha migrado bastante y ha migrado hacia conceptos en donde intentamos involucrar información de otro tipo. Uno de los conceptos que van a encontrar tal vez de autores de la parte de la informática dicen que la informática también se han venido creciendo es por la idea de que medir es conocer. Y hay diferentes tipos de mediciones hoy en día en diferentes sectores. Pero aún así, las mediciones son complejas. ¿De qué hablamos cuando hablamos de mediciones complejas? Mediciones heterogéneas, como este tipo de imágenes. Mediciones de resultados de modelos que cambian en espacio y tiempo. Mediciones de tal vez ecosistemas variados, muy hermosos, pero variados. Y también mediciones de lo que tenemos en ese momento y de cómo hacemos nuestra gestión de recursos hídricos, de qué manera todas estas mediciones nos pueden ayudar a mejorar los recursos hídricos o la gestión con la que lo hacemos. Entonces, uno de los principios de hidroinformática es, bueno, tenemos muchos datos, pero necesitamos de esos datos extraer información y de esa información poder aprender o conocer algo y después tomar unas decisiones, tener un poco de sabiduría. Eso combinado con la idea de que la toma de decisiones son costosas y hay costos en diferentes áreas. En la parte de inundaciones, esto que estamos viendo acá es la parte baja del río Junia en República Dominicana. Y pueden ver que los resultados de la inundación afectaron bastante a una de las ciudades principales de República Dominicana. Tenemos también sequías y tenemos problemas, por ejemplo, este que están viendo acá es el río Magdalena en general. Estamos viendo uno de los tributarios y esta es la represa del Nechi. El Nechi representa el 16% de la energía de todo el país, de toda Colombia. El manejar o operar esa represa se puede hacer en diferentes maneras, pero la operación, ¿sí? Lo que ven en la parte de abajo, es un segundo que no veo bien, es tal vez mejor algo así. Es por la primera es la cantidad de energía producida, después la alteración del flujo y después la cantidad de daño que podremos hacer en inundaciones. Y si se dan cuenta, un esquema de estos multiobjetivo con una presentación en tres dimensiones no es tan sencillo obtener. Necesitamos hacer todos los análisis que hay. Para eso, entonces obviamente empezamos a hacer análisis multicriteria, sistemas de optimización multiobjetivo, y todo eso es parte de lo que nosotros pensamos que son tecnologías de hidroinformática. ¿Qué más tenemos? Tenemos necesidades en los recursos hídricos en términos de manejar nuestra información, y eso va creciendo poco a poco. Necesitamos de alguna manera almacenar los datos, visualizarlos y hacer análisis predictivos. ¿Cómo lo hacemos? Hoy en día tenemos datos en grandes cantidades, Big Data, tenemos información en la nube y tenemos datos que son enviados en tiempo real. Todo eso nos lleva a conceptos que hoy en día aplicamos en diferentes áreas. El área que yo manejo o que más he trabajado es en la parte de inundaciones. Por eso adicioné un par de slides que muestren el concepto de las inundaciones. Esto es lo que normalmente vemos cuando tenemos un evento de inundaciones. Vemos simplemente las consecuencias y de qué manera ellas afectan. Pero, ¿cómo ocurren las inundaciones? Y este es un ejemplo de una de ellas. Esto es son unas imágenes de Crystal Prudhomme del Environmental Center for Hydrology en UK, en Inglaterra. Y este es el principal centro de investigaciones de inundaciones de toda Inglaterra, uno de los más avanzados del mundo. Y se inundó. Eso quiere decir, ella resalta, y el mensaje que ella quiere dar en ese momento es que no todas las inundaciones son de la misma manera. Segundo, algunas inundaciones son impredecibles. Esta es una inundación pluvial que se generó debido a bajas lluvias con un periodo largo y extenso que no se pudo manejar de ninguna manera y generó grandes problemas al instituto. Pero hay otros tipos de inundaciones, no solo esa. Estas son inundaciones rápidas y vienen por el río. Son lo que llaman flash floods en algún momento. Son muy intensas en sitios concentrados que son bastante vulnerables. Esto se presenta bastante en los países del Caribe, República Dominicana. Otro tipo de inundaciones, el incremento del nivel freático por fenómenos naturales o fenómenos tal vez también antropogénicos. tormentas cerca de las zonas costeras o deshielos, y esto también es bastante común en Europa. En Holanda y Alemania, cuando hay cambio de estaciones entre la parte de invierno y primavera, se empieza a descongelar el hielo y las cantidades de agua que empiezan a salir para a alimentar los ríos no se pueden estimar fácilmente y poco a poco van generando volúmenes que generan inundaciones. Todo eso nos lleva a empezar a implementar sistemas de nuevo, de hidroinformática, nuevas tecnologías. Esto que están viendo acá es un screenshot del sistema de alerta temprana que es más usado en el mundo, diría yo. Ese es el Flood Early Warning System, el DELFUSE, que en Estados Unidos es el National Science Prediction Model. Pero ¿de dónde salen esos modelos que utilizamos dentro de esos sistemas? Entonces vuelve de nuevo el concepto que teníamos antes de hidroinformática. Empezar a utilizar las ecuaciones y crear nuestros modelos físicos. Crear modelos físicos es bastante costoso y no es fácil. Teniendo las tecnologías y teniendo los recursos computacionales, avanzamos un poco más. Y llegamos a modelos un poco más avanzados. Vamos a ver si esta animación sale, como estos. Esto es parte de un trabajo que estamos haciendo con un estudiante doctoral, y esta cuenca que ven acá es la cuenca del río Jundiaí en Brasil, y lo que estamos haciendo es un análisis de los últimos 10 años de eventos extremos, y lo que hemos hecho es la variación espaciotemporal de todos los eventos de precipitación que ocurrieron en ese periodo y de qué manera fueron afectando poco a poco la cuenca. Esto es un ejemplo más, a ver si podemos salir, de cómo modelaciones de diferente tipo nos pueden ayudar a entender y de hecho a manejar y planear mejor las respuestas para esas inundaciones. El concepto del manejo de la inundación es muy sencillo y se puede ver a veces con simples procesos como ven acá, la evapotranspiración, flujo superficial, flujo subsuperficial, el interflujo, la recarga, el agua subterránea y todo. Al final asumimos que simplemente es una cuenca que alimenta todo y sale por un solo punto, lo cual muchas veces no es perfecto. Esto lo asimilamos, si es un sistema de respuesta rápida, lo asimilamos a un concepto un poquito más adaptado a ecuaciones, y lo hacemos con sistemas de tanques. Eso es un ejemplo, pero ¿cómo funciona cuando ya empezamos a unir una cosa con la otra? Entonces tenemos primero el concepto atmosférico, después nos vamos a la parte hidrológica, después tenemos que hacer una modelación del río, que es la parte hidrodinámica y cómo se comporta, y después miramos ese río de qué manera se expande y me genera una mancha de inundación y cuáles son las consecuencias de esa mancha. Todo eso es la base de la parte de hidroinformática, al menos de las inundaciones. Esto que les voy a presentar son algunas experiencias de estudiantes de maestría y de doctorado. La primera es un estudiante de maestría, se llama Alberto Pinto. Él trabajó con el grupo de H.R. Wallingford durante su periodo de maestría, y lo que estaba buscando es la modelación con medidas naturales de protección a las inundaciones. Teníamos un terreno que se inunda todos los años en Inglaterra. Hay un sistema que ya está haciendo la modelación, pero queríamos mirar de qué manera, si empezamos a implementar medidas naturales de protección, como creación de zanjas, como creación de áreas de inundación que se puedan canalizar en el momento del evento, y otro tipo de inundaciones, de qué manera podríamos encontrar que el agua se distribuye o que la energía cinética que lleva el agua se pueda disminuir, etcétera. Todo eso nos permitió poder hacer análisis y tomar una combinación de medidas que me podían mejorar el sistema. Otro sistema interesante es, por ejemplo, el trabajo de Jason Ernst. Esto lo está haciendo en República Dominicana. Está basado en una serie de proyectos de la Unión Europea que trabajaban o monitoreaban información con telefonía celular o presentaban sistemas en tiempo real y buscaban el concepto de información dinámica, de qué manera dinámicamente puedo obtener información de precipitación a través, por ejemplo, de una sombrilla que tenga un sensor o que alguien esté pasando por cerca de un punto de emisión y tome una foto, etcétera. Lo que buscamos en este proyecto es buscar de qué manera un sistema en línea de información y de predicción de inundaciones se puede combinar con un sistema de comunicación social, por ejemplo, Facebook, y ver de qué manera le podemos involucrar a la gente dentro del sistema. Ellos van a ser parte de una comunidad que va a estar encargada de proveer información y también compartir entre ellos sus experiencias y lo que ellos están pensando de lo que está presentando el sistema. ¿Qué hicimos? Creamos, con toda la información que teníamos, creamos modelos de inundaciones en la región, creamos todas las capas y las almacenamos. Creamos una base de datos con la información que se tiene de eventos pasados y le conectamos un sistema en tiempo real que provee servicios de información a una página de Facebook. Y dentro de esa página de Facebook conectamos las entidades y los ciudadanos. Ahora, cada ciudadano está, digamos, tiene acceso a Facebook, pero también él está cerca de las estaciones de medición. Lo que estaba ocurriendo en República Dominicana es que también ellos no veían el uso de eso. Venía una institución del gobierno, pone una estación de medición y a los 2 meses alguien se había robado la batería y a nadie le interesaba nada y el sistema de medición se caía. Por medio de involucrar a la comunidad, ellos están viendo el sistema, tanto en su computador o en su celular, o están viendo también qué está ocurriendo en las diferentes zonas de su región. Y eso ha generado un poquito más de sentido de pertenencia. Ya saben para qué es eso, además de que están viendo las señales en un mapita dentro de Facebook. Este es otro concepto. Tenemos conceptos, y esto fue parte de mi doctorado, que fue la combinación precisamente de, dentro de sistemas de alertas tempranas, crear modelos de inteligencia artificial. Y lo que hicimos fue, dentro del MEUS, teníamos una capacidad predictiva de 24 horas. Teníamos una serie de modelos hidrológicos, físicos o conceptuales, y lo que se quería buscar era de qué manera podríamos mejorar 24 horas de predicción en la entrada de Holanda. El sistema utiliza información de 7 agencias meteorológicas, cada agencia proveía de 52 pronósticos, y la idea es que a través, combinando toda esa información, necesitamos obtener la mejor predicción posible. ¿Qué se hizo? Se empezó a reemplazar región por región con modelos de redes neuronales y se creó un sistema que adaptaba al tipo de lluvia que se tenía para hacer el reemplazo entre el modelo físico y el modelo de inteligencia artificial. Esos son ejemplos que ayudan a mostrar que tecnologías de información pueden ser combinadas. Este es el último ejemplo que quiero presentarles. Es un ejemplo práctico que se está haciendo en el CIAT en Colombia, en la ciudad de Palmira. Estamos creando lo que se llaman un sistema de optimización de las Agricultural Best Management Practice. La estudiante de doctorado Natalia Uribe tiene bastante experiencia en el sistema de modulación SWAT, y lo que buscamos es que la práctica agrícola se realiza en la región en donde tenga el mayor beneficio del agua, teniendo en cuenta la variabilidad que tiene el ciclo hidrológico, y la variabilidad se va a contemplar en espacio y tiempo. Buscamos también una serie de parámetros para hacer esta optimización, entre ellos era la parte de inundaciones, pero también la parte económica y también la parte de contaminación o polución que se está generando con la práctica agrícola. Esto se está trabajando en este momento, también lo estamos trabajando con Texas A&M, con el grupo que desarrolló el modelo SWAT. Los primeros resultados que hemos hecho, los hemos hecho agrupando regiones similares, y lo que creamos fue este pequeño sistemita en donde creamos un modelo hidrológico, creamos los algoritmos de optimización que iba a trabajar, y como ven, tenemos un grupo de objetivos que empezamos a combinar. Y miramos por estaciones, entonces estación 1, estación 2 y estación 3. Creo que eso es todo lo que les quería presentar para darles como una introducción de algunas cosas que se están haciendo. Hay muchas más, pero creo que más adelante Andrea Yunowski les va a presentar un poquito más de un concepto un poquito más grande, ya no solo a nivel de estudiantes de maestría, sino a proyectos grandes de la Unión Europea que tienen mucho más impacto, tienen muchas compañías con expertos de diferentes áreas interactuando y que tal vez pueda ser de su interés. Bueno, gracias.
¿Alguna pregunta para el doctor Corso?
Como una curiosidad.
Sí, claro.
Nada más que como que nunca me ha quedado claro en realidad qué es la hidroinformática.
Ah.
O, por ejemplo, pues, con la dinámica de fluido computacional, ¿cómo se separan, digamos?
Hay muchas definiciones de la hidroinformática. La que manejamos nosotros está relacionada con la integración de la información, comunicaciones, tecnologías de información y comunicaciones dentro de los problemas con los recursos hídricos. Y eso se extiende a sistemas de modelación, obviamente todo lo que es computational hydraulics, en donde usted necesita implementar todas sus ecuaciones dentro de un sistema computacional que le represente un fenómeno, una región con un modelo. Entonces, se puede aplicar a la parte de medio ambiente, se puede aplicar a la parte de modelación de calidad de agua con imágenes satelitales, hay todo tipo de desarrollos en
diferentes. Pero, digamos, la parte de la dinámica de fluido computacional también entra dentro de la informática.
Claro, sí. Claro, fue donde nació. Sí. Bueno, gracias.
Vamos a then we have our last speaker is Dr. Andrea Yunowski. He's also a senior lecturer at the Department of Hydroinformatics at IHG. He's originally from Macedonia, where he graduated as a civil engineer from the University of St. Cyril and Methodius in Skopje. Is that well pronounced? Skopje. Okay. In 1988. Then until 1994, he worked at the Civil Engineering Institute Macedonia at the Geotechnics Division, first as a groundwater hydrologist and later as a head of the division. In 1996, he obtained his master's degree at IHG Delft in groundwater hydrology on the topic of optimization of artificial recharge. And then in 2002, he defended his PhD on the topic of decision support systems for enabling stakeholder and citizens' participation in water and environment-related decision-making process. Since 2001, he works as staff member of the Hydroinformatics Chair Group. He teaches courses in groundwater flow and transport modeling, physically-based catch and modeling, river basin management, and hydroinformatics technologies for decision support. Please, Dr. Yunowski.
I offer this thing with my presentation.
Yeah, it's actually working.
It's stuck.
Yeah. I think he's handling there.
Is he handling something there? Okay.
What's going on?
Okay, while they are preparing this, I can start. I mean, we don't need always slides.
Yes. So I apologize that I will speak in English. I don't speak Spanish, so I hope that you will be able to follow me. I will talk, as Gerald suggested, a little bit more about some examples of research projects that we carried out supported by the funding sources.
He told me that the file is corrupted, so he needs...
The file is corrupted?
Somehow, yeah. He needs some...
Not corrupted, I was running on my computer to see the files.
Okay.
I mean, in our chair group of hybrid informatics, for the past 10, 15 years, we have been working on a number of projects that were funded from the sources that are coming from the European Commission. European Commission has a number of programs that usually run for 5 years or maybe 7 years, and they have different objectives and funding to different universities in Europe. And the objective is always to bring consortia of a number of organizations, universities, but also industry partners, end user partners. So the projects are always consortia of mixed types of partners that will propose a certain research projects and demonstrate that there are some positive effects from this research with the end users.
So I will say a few words about your question, maybe, which is about what is hydroinformatics. You see, I will bring all these things together now. Hydroinformatics tries to cover the whole cycle from data via modeling to this decision support, okay, how to support the decision. So hydroinformatics is not only about modeling, it's not only about information systems, and it's not only here in this part about decision support. So it tries to cover the whole cycle, which is sometimes a bit too much, I understand, but we are ambitious in our field. We want to cover this whole field. And things are nowadays changing. In the past, in our water problems, we were lacking data. Okay? That was really a problem that we usually did not have in our data. Now, there are many things that are changing. We have satellites. We have remote sensing. We have advances in new sensor technologies. So increasingly, we will move from this data poor into data rich environments. And this brings new kind of problems to deal with. One of the main problems is that we have different organizations, different people coming up with different ways of collecting and storing and presenting this data. So our water systems need to be integrated, so that means that we would like this data to talk to each other, to be exchanged more. So we have these problems of diverse data models, so a number of people in our field are working on standardization, different protocols, different standards, how to represent data, how to be able to connect this data together for useful purposes. In the traditional hydroinformatics block that is about modeling, we always recognize that you need to have application-specific expertise. So if you want to do a model of flooding in a river, you really have to know river hydraulics first, then to be able to model it. Or if you want to model groundwater system, you really have to understand groundwater or water quality or whatever. So that is necessary if you want to develop good models. But there are some issues that are cutting across all these different modeling approaches. How to calibrate models, how to test the sensitivity of models to different parameters, how to do this uncertainty analysis, and then how to combine these models. We are still, maybe because of our traditional focus on separate disciplines, we are developing separate models, separate model for groundwater, separate model for river, separate model for surface water in the catchment. And there is a very strong need to develop combinations of models, models that will combine these different systems together. Yes? So that is something that is also belongs here in this group. And of course, what Gerald was presenting a little bit, this model building, artificial intelligence technique, in which you can construct models out of data. So it's like statistics, but now much more powerful than statistics. Okay. And because our more complex model need more computational power, we have to look into this increasingly available infrastructure for computing and storing of data. So that's also here important for our models. Here in this block is the most complex part, actually, because here we are facing the real world, so to say. We want to help decision makers, policy makers, support stakeholders to work together on water and environmental problems. And here we have a number of topics that are keeping us busy. So optimization is a very important one. I will talk on maybe more about that. Multi-criteria analysis, But then this whole way of supporting different actors and stakeholders in the water, how can we create still ICT-based systems, but now that are really for supporting stakeholders? It's not so much about making efficient models or making better data, but about creating environments in which different actors can participate. And we have different techniques. The technology is very much advanced. We have web and mobile phone applications. We have what we call now citizens observatories, where we want to engage citizens in collecting data and through this process becoming more aware of the environmental and water problems. So all these aspects are addressed in part of our research. So here, as I said, it's a bit more messy because it's a mix of social and technical data that we have to deal with. So my presentation of the project will be mainly about this last part. I will start with something that we call model-based optimization. Gerald touched a little bit about what that is, but I want to present it in a more structured way. Okay? Optimization, and as some of you may know, is basically a mathematical problem. Okay? Imagine that you have certain goal that you want to minimize something or maximize something. Okay? Maybe you want to maximize the irrigated area from a given project, or to minimize the cost of a certain intervention. You can say that that is a function, that cost function, let's say, will depend on a number of different decision variables. Variables that you can manipulate and control, that's why they are called decision variables. And you want to find a combination of these variables that will give you the minimum or the maximum point. So this is the most important concept in optimization, that you have an objective function that you want to minimize or maximize, and that you have decision variables that you manipulate in order to find these extreme points. Of course, there are other issues like constraints. Sometimes you can vary these decision variables only within certain ranges, so you have to take care of that. But the essence is decision variables and objective functions. So here we have only one objective function. You can imagine that this is let's say cost minimization, and you want to find this minimum point. Okay. So people have been working with optimization for decades. Okay. And optimization is very broad topic, and people take different approaches depending on the nature of that function. So what really guides the approach to optimization is what kind of function are you dealing with. If it is nice, easily expressible function in differentiable form, you can take derivatives. Use classical calculus-based methods, and by taking derivatives, you can find the extreme points. Those of you who remember calculus would recognize that. If the function is linear, there are special techniques called linear programming. What is increasingly keeping us busy is that we are dealing with very complex functions, sometimes not even known functions. Why they are not known? Because they are generated by running a model. You have a complex model that takes all kinds of different decision variables, like the hydrological model that Gerald was talking about, that SWOT model, for example. There are many parameters, many inputs. You run that model and you create certain values as outputs. And some of these outputs would be your objective function. So you cannot represent it in a nice mathematical way. So there is a model that creates the values of your objective function. And when we want to combine optimization techniques and algorithms with that kind of function, which is simply a model run, then we talk about model-based optimization. Okay? And these are usually what are known as search-based methods. So what does it mean, search-based? You look into that decision space that is formed by the decision variables and try to find what would be the best combination of these decision variables to find this minimum or maximum point. But you don't know really how that space looks like and how the objective function looks like. So what do? You have a model, you run the model, calculate the value of the objective function, feed that in some type of algorithm of optimization, which is a search-based algorithm. This is the intelligence here. So that algorithm will say, maybe try in the next iteration new decision variables, feed that to the model, run the model again. Okay? And you run that many, many, many times until you don't have any increase in the improvements of the objective function. Then you say, okay, maybe I'm okay now, so I'm close to the optimal solution. That is the general setup. One more thing that is important to be mentioned, that we usually in water problems do not have one objective, but we have more than one objective, okay? Any water system would have at least some sort of performance measure and some cost associated with that, okay? So you want to minimize the cost and maximize the performance in whatever way you define that. And these are usually conflicting objectives, okay? When you have more than one objective, let's say that you have two objectives or criteria that you want to maximize. You want to maximize this criterion and you want to maximize that criterion. When you do that, you are trying to find the set of best points. These are lying along this frontier, which is sometimes called efficiency frontier or Pareto frontier. Why are these the best points? Well, if you are at this point, obviously, you can do better by moving in this direction. You increase C1, you also increase C2. However, if you're in this point, if you move in this direction, you indeed increase C1, but you decrease C2. So this is the frontier where the compromise points lie. Okay? You have two objectives, and here are the trade-offs between the two objectives. And these are the best points, but of course, at the end, you have to decide how you pick, whether you pick this one. Maybe this one is the 50-50 compromise, if you wish, between the different objectives. Okay, so that is the objective in multi-objective optimization, to find this Pareto frontier. If your problem is minimization, then the same frontier would look something like this. That will be the shape of that frontier, rather than like that for maximization. Okay, it's just the type of optimization problem that would lead to different shapes of the Pareto frontier. Now, I had to go through this brief introduction so that you will know what we are after in at least one of these projects that I want to talk to you about. In the period between 2012 and 2015, we were working on one of the 10 large research projects that the European Commission funded in the field of ICT for water. Okay, that was the big theme. They funded 10 projects, each around 5 million euro, okay, large projects. And we were involved in one, which we're trying to define in one sentence like this bullet. What do you want to achieve? To increase energy and water efficiencies, so both energy and water efficiencies, using latest sensor technologies, pressure, flow, energy, leakage sensors, whatever you have, connected via wireless technologies to monitoring, management, and decision support system components using overall system architecture based on web services. Now, web services is a computer science term. It's one term that nowadays explains easy access to data on the web. Let's put it as simple as that. Okay. But there are some special protocols that you can use how to develop these web services. We were in this consortium. At that time, we were called UNESCO IG still, as you see here from the logo. And we were in a large consortium. There were two utilities, one in the city of Milan in Italy and one in Timișoara in Romania, that brought in parts of their distribution networks as pilot case studies. We had large industrial partners like Siemens, Toshiba, and several other research institutes and small and media enterprises contributing to this project. Now, I will focus on the work that we did here, and that was the water supply system of Milan in Italy. Large city, 1.3 million people live there. All the water comes from groundwater. All the water comes from groundwater. So you need to first pump the water out of the ground, bring it to these red points that represent relatively small surface tanks, and from these tanks, you pump the water with large pumps into the water distribution network, okay? So two-stage pumping, once from the wells, then with these booster pumps into the network. Very costly, okay? A lot of pumping, a lot of energy consumption, a lot of money. So their objective was to save energy. Additional problem was that the system was managed as one big pressure management zone. What does it mean? That the whole system is interconnected. They are not separate blocks of the city. And you have one pressure gradient surface, if you wish. The system is in a topography that goes from north to south like this, declining topography. And that means that here in the south, you create fairly large pressures. Okay? And this is also a problem because if you have too high pressures, the pipes are bursting, you have to repair these very often, and this kind of problem. So we could either think of dividing this network into blocks, sectorize this network and operate separately, or to think of how we can pump in a better way that will save the energy, okay? So that we will schedule the pumping in a bit better way. What the project offered and the utility offered was this southernmost part of the network was completely isolated from the rest of the network for all these tests. So the other partners installed the sensors, the wireless communication. In the operation room, they were having access to these decision support systems that we were developing. So that was all done for that that pilot area. We developed a model using the ARPANET modeling system, and then in the central area is the main pumping station where we had initially four pumps, then two of them were replaced by variable speed pumps. These are pumps that can vary their speed, okay? And in that way, be more flexible how much water they will pump rather than on-off pumps that would just turn off and turn on. We had certain demands from the utility that was also researched by some other partners how these demand patterns were varying. And then we introduced this model-based optimization. We said we will formulate the pump scheduling problem as an optimization problem. Divide the 24 hours in half-hour or hourly slots. How much will be pumped in each hourly slot will be decision variable. And we want to minimize the energy and the cost primarily. And the performance, we selected one indicator, which is called lack of resilience, that we used as a second objective. Okay? We also introduced some pressure constraints. And then this is how these decision variables in a 24-hour period would look like for on-off pumps. And this is for variable speed pumps. You would vary the speeds between 0.7 and 1 of the nominal speed of the pump, or the rotational speed of the pump. These are the equations of the objective functions. Okay, this is this resilience objective, and this is energy or cost, basically the same thing, just that you have to multiply with the cost factor the energy. This is about pressure constraints that we introduced, not so important. And here we have exactly the same slide that I showed you earlier. Now, how it looks for this problem. You start here, you propose certain pumping schedule. Okay, two pumps here, one red, one green. You feed this into the model, run the model runs, you get results in terms of pressure and energy, how much is consumed. You provide this to a genetic algorithm, that was the one that was used. Actually, we used two different to test their performance. The algorithm then gives back new decision variables and the loop continues, okay? There are several tests here. I want to show you how this Pareto set looked like from our results. This is minimization of energy and minimization of this lack of resilience. This lack of resilience was not a big issue here. You see the variations are very small. If you look at these numbers, you want as close as possible to zero to be with that indicator. But we are indeed all the time very close to zero. So actually these lowest points in terms of energy consumption were the best points. Now, this was very interesting. We developed not only the algorithms, we also prepared a web-based decision support system for the people to use this algorithm. And that was work done by two of our PhD students. And the nicest part in this project, as I said, was that we test what we have developed in this real system of Abbiategrasso. So with our algorithms, we proposed in the month of June, in the end of the project in 2015, a number of tests how our proposed pump schedules would compare to the existing pump schedules that they were using. And we measured all the energy consumption and everything what was happening. And we, as you see here in this graph, during a particular day, we generated savings of about 18%, which was very, very satisfying. Okay? Now, this approach of model-based optimization we use in many different problems. I mean, if we have time, I can show you problems of different nature. Flood protection, reservoir operation, groundwater problems, all with a similar setup of mixing models and optimization. Okay. You need computational power if your model is very complex, but it can be very, very powerful technique. But, as I said in the introduction, this is not the whole story. When you start moving into this multiple stakeholder business, then optimization is simply not enough. Each stakeholder will have different optimization function in their minds, at least, you know? So how to bring all these things together? You have to create more platform for communication rather than for computation. So that's an important shift that we have here when we come into this this area. So I will show you briefly now. Please be patient with me. It's not more than 10 brief slides. Some projects where we were busy with this kind of platforms. One of the earliest one was from 2009 and 2013. It was called EnviroGrids, very big research project. I think it was around 10 million euro. It was focused on all the countries around the Black Sea. And the idea at that time was to create these web services. At that time, web services were a very new thing. So how you can create different web services that would be shared for different societal benefits. And we worked, for our part, in the country of Romania. We had two case studies, one in the northern part of the country with mountainous catchment, very prone to flash floods, natural flash floods, okay, that are still from the catchment and the river, not from urban flash floods. And here we had a problem of on the Danube River. See here, I don't know if you can see, this is the picture that I want to show you. This is, in this area, the big Danube River that goes in this part of Romania. And here, there is another river called Prut, and there is also another river called Siret. And here, there is a city called Galați. And then there is a big problem here when the peaks of the flood from the three rivers would coincide. If they all come at the same time, then this city is really in trouble. Yes, that's a really bad thing. So what we did there, we worked with the Romanian Water Authority. They are people who are managing the big waters in the country. And they brought in different stakeholders in the two case studies. And together with them, we developed what we called flood information portals. We developed hydrological model for the Someș Mare, that northern catchment. And we developed another portal for the Danube case study. And it was supposed to be used not only for the awareness raising of the citizens, but also, you don't read here, maybe you don't see, this was also developed in Romanian language, so that stakeholders and citizens in the area could report issues and floods back to this web portal. Similar things was done for the Danube case study. You see here, we presented different scenarios. This was more for planning purposes with authorities, not so much with citizens, but how the floods might develop in this area for different combinations of flood peaks coming on the three different groups. It was one of the first real projects with stakeholders and citizens that we worked, and we developed ourselves. That was our task in IHG, in Hydroinformatics Group, to develop these interfaces, the web interfaces. All these portals and the models were developed by us. And it was nice that we could test them a little bit in this project with the stakeholders. Next, more significant project was this one. Here, it was again about flooding, but it was much more oriented towards this stakeholder engagement. Okay? And we combined web platforms that we developed with workshops. And we had case studies in United Kingdom and Germany. The web platforms were basically two websites, one for the German case study in German, for the UK case study in English. And in the UK case study, we had very localized problem. I don't know, I didn't mention here, I don't have that slide. In the UK case study, was really small urban area prone to pluvial flooding, flooding directly from rainfall in the summer when it rains a lot. In the German case study, it was more of a catchment and river flooding in the northern part of Germany. Our job was to develop this collaborative modeling part. And what was that? Together with the different stakeholders, we defined the objectives of flood planning, if you wish, the different alternatives that they want to be tested, and a system on the web how each individual stakeholders would be able to evaluate which alternative from their point of view would be the best. Okay? So there were interfaces like that. They would select different objectives which are important or not important for them, and then they will test different alternatives of the measures and how the flooding would result in the picture. What we create afterwards is that for each individual stakeholder there is a certain profile, like Facebook or Google tries to profile you in a certain way and maybe sell you something on the next day. This was a profile of your position as a stakeholder in this flood management problem. And that would mean that for me, let's say, this is how I rank the alternatives. I had to also provide some explanation why I prefer that to that objective. And then we bring all these stakeholders together. We try to represent both individual positions and the positions of the group as a whole. So these colors would represent that this is the alternative that is most preferred by the whole group. But these are the different positions of the stakeholders. And it was tested with real stakeholders in the final workshops with the stakeholders. And it was very interesting, and participants liked it very much. They immediately demanded more information. But the project ended, and we didn't continue. And that's a very dangerous, I would like to say, for this kind of projects, because stakeholders can be really disappointed if they are engaged, their expectations are raised, and then nothing happens. Few words about how we work with mobile phones. We current smartphones are basically small computers. You can actually do all kinds of things that you do with the web on the mobile phone nowadays. So developed a number of applications. One of the important projects was called LEMVIS, Localized Environmental Information Services for All. And here we wanted to work again with a number of different partners to simply disseminate important information via mobile phones to these different stakeholders. Our case studies were in the Netherlands, mainly related to water quality in two catchments here in the south. We developed these applications in collaboration with the provinces, and we tested them with them mainly. This was about some catchments that were prone to water quality problems, and this was about some ponds and small lakes that people use for swimming. So water quality problem was there also an important. This is the last slide, and the current project that we are working on is called Citizens Observatories Project, or Citizens Engagement. As I mentioned in that slide, here we try to develop complete systems of web and mobile phone applications that will support citizens in basically collecting data. And our project is primarily about citizens collecting data with taking pictures and videos. Okay. Also with some portable sensors, okay, that they can collect some data, but mainly pictures and videos. And they will also annotate these pictures and videos, and then we will use them in our flood models to see if we can improve the flood models. Here you see a number of gaming applications done by some of our partners. They want this data collection process of pictures and videos to be inside a game that will be implemented in the mobile phones. And we just started a year ago. We are still preparing this whole setup. We will have two case studies in the delta of this Danube River, which is here on the Black Sea in Romania, and in the capital of Greece in Athens. So next time when I come here, maybe I will tell you if we were successful with that or not. It's very ambitious. We will see how that will work. Thank you very much. Yeah, that is an indicator that was proposed by Professor Todini in Italy. I can give you the paper if you're interested. Not so relevant for this system. It's about the total available power that you have in the network compared to the total power that you have in the system divided by your total available power. How much you could restore with pumps available, or if you have tanks, you can also have a different formula that the tanks can provide the water. And if you have a problem that suddenly there is a burst and there is a drop of pressure, how quickly, given this indicator, your system will be able to recover by switching on additional pumps or getting water from different tanks. Okay, and that is called that the system is resilient to these kind of problems. Okay. It's really the ratio of two powers. If you here, you see it's Q multiplied by a hat, and here you have power divided by gamma, and here you have Q multiplied by H. So it's about power available power to restore the system. Okay, but if you're interested, just look for resilience and the Todini. Todini is the author, and you will find the paper, or send me an email, I can send you the paper about that. For Milan, not a big problem, because in Milan the problem was that we had even too much pumping capacity. You know, they're pumping too much. In the past, the city was actually needing more water, and they're keeping on pumping this, you know, just to be sure that there is water, but they are spending too much pumping energy, and they wanted to reduce to make it more optimal. But we wanted to have a more generic algorithm, you know, so that we could use it also in systems that are not so resilient as Milan.
Thank you for a great presentation and great review.
Thank you.
I was just wondering, I would like to pick your brain on this. I was looking at the situation of the life of the scenes. I was wondering that the main issue for most of the water supply systems is I will guess that links, if you fix the links, maybe...
Yeah, sure. You will increase the resilience.
Of course.
Yeah. So
I don't see that there. So
there is... Well, it is implicit, because this is available head. Your available head here will depend on the links. If you have large number of links, then your available head will be small.
Of course, yeah.
And this is the required head that you have at certain nodes. So here in the upper part, you have the available head, and that is implicit there. Of course, leakage is also not a very big problem in this case that we had. In the Romanian case, the leakages were very high. So there we had problems maybe on water deficiency, water efficiency improvement, but in Milan was energy the main target.
And the aging infrastructure, because that...
Aging infrastructure, where I can tell you, I have other slides, but we don't have time now. Here there is a partner, which Vital Data, was developing as part of this big system. I'm showing only what we did. Okay? Other partners did other things. These guys were developing this asset management part for these two case studies, and they were looking into, together with the... this is a funny logo, CMR from Italy. They were also trying to develop some algorithms how you can estimate when to go with the replacement of pipes, when to go with the asset management actions that you would like to have. And they developed also some systems. All the decision support systems developed were web-based. Okay, so it was interesting. And some of them were picked up by the utilities, but not everything. Of course, it was a research project, so...
Thank you.
You're welcome. Yes.
Okay, thank you for I haven't worked with some things similar. I didn't know they were also hybrid informatics. So my question is regarding communication. How important communication. So I'm curious about, for example, for this pumping system communication. Are those different systems or do you do it manually?
Somebody needed to put these systems together. And it was one of our research students, one of our PhDs, who developed the coupling, we call it coupling, of the EPAMET model with the optimization algorithm. For initial testing, this was all done in MATLAB, because MATLAB is an environment where you can try things, you know? But for the actual system that we deployed, we actually implemented everything in C++, and then C++ was converted into something that is called PHP libraries. I don't know how familiar you are with the computer languages and technologies. At the end, all the services for running this optimization were PHP libraries. And the background was this code, C++ code, that contained the coupling of the model with the and then a web interface on the front, presenting the network and selecting the I have the slides here, or not here, somewhere to my computer, but it's short time here. So if you look at it.
Any other questions?
Yes, please.
I don't support is open.
Which one?
Not everything is open source. EPANET is open source. Here, results of this project, a large part is not really and openly available because of these names. When you see these names, these are. It was an interesting experience to work with such large industrial partners. So the Siemens was actually coordinating the project, and they were very protective of some of their things that they were doing. Toshiba a bit less. Toshiba was mainly busy with the wireless communication, so they were testing where to put exactly these repeaters, they call them, of the signal, so that they would cover the signal properly and the signal from these different sensors will come at the center. Okay, so they were building models of this wireless environment, of these sensors and repeaters. So, but they were less protective, but Siemens a bit more. The models that we used, EPANET is open source. The algorithms, optimization algorithms are easily open source. You can find them. Some of these models are not open source. So, I don't know. In Romania, we used free software, but not open source. So, it's different. For some cases, we used commercial software. For some cases, in IG, we have access to both. We are collaborating with companies that provide commercial software. For research purposes, they help us and give us this software. And we have different people at IIG liking different things. There are some open source champions who want to do everything only with open source, maybe like you. And there are others who say, look, real world, real companies use commercial software. We have to be also using commercial software. So it's a mix.
Another question from
Do you work with other universities in Netherlands?
These projects are European research projects. So the case studies and most of the partners are European. The link with our institute to most of the researchers are our students from developing countries or southern countries. So here in this project, there were people from Colombia and from China. The current project is somebody from Brazil.
From IIG, not from other universities.
Well, we work with other universities, but not on these particular projects.
Okay.
but of course we work with other Dutch universities. This particular project, there was no link with other Dutch universities with that solution.
How do I get out of this? Or it doesn't matter.
I think he will close it.
Okay. That's it.
Okay, so if there's no more questions, I will close the seminar. We thank you very much to all the three speakers that came today to give some insights about the IHE Delft and their research, their different research activities and projects. So thank you very much also for you for coming. I think that the presentations will be available on the YouTube channel. So if you are interested at some point to have a look again, you can do it. Okay, thank you very much. Have a nice evening.